We shall now be talking about industrial policy. After studying this module, you would understand the industrial policies framed by the central government from time to time. You would be able to appreciate why the industrial policy of 1999 is considered to be a landmark policy in the path of India's economic development. You would be able to compare the achievements attained during the adoption of the industrial policy prior to the reform period of 1991 and thereafter. You would be able to assess if the government has achieved its objectives in respect of the implementation of the industrial policies. Now, the industrial policy of a nation is its official policy to promote growth and development of the manufacturing sector of the economy. These policies are formulated to address the various manufacturing and infrastructure sectors of the problems of the manufacturing and the infrastructure sectors of the economy. There are specific policies meant for various subsectors within the industrial sector. To begin with, in April 1956, the Parliament of India passed the industrial policy resolution according to which the industries were classified into three categories, in three schedules as we call it. The Schedule A industries were those industries that would be exclusive responsibility of the state. Schedule B industries included those industries which are the responsibility of the state owned as well as those owned by the private sector who would be supplementing the effort of the state. And Schedule C was meant to include the remaining industries which are left to be undertaken by the private sector. So this was the main feature of the Industrial Policy Resolution 1956. As per this resolution, the objective of the social and economic policy of India was equitable distribution of wealth and the formation of a socialistic pattern of society. It was delivered with more controls done by the government machinery, and accordingly the industrial policy of 1956 is known as the economic constitution of the country because it is in keeping with what is known as the directive principles of state policy enshrined in the Constitution of India. Now, let us discuss the industrial policy up to 1991. Up to 1991, the industrial policy followed a conservative approach. It provided a protective environment for industry, and these are some of the features of the industrial policy up to 1991. Many industries were reserved for the public sector only. In most cases, the import substituting industries were reserved for the public sector. It was believed that the private sector did not have enough funds to invest in the case of the heavy industry and basic industries, and that the private sector would not really come forward for such areas where the return was low and the gestation period was very long. And therefore, many of the capital goods industries, the heavy industries, the infrastructural projects, all such projects which were more or less meant for the welfare of the economy rather than for profit making were actually reserved for the public sector. This is how the industrial policy played a role in developing the socialistic pattern of society. The public sector was dominant in the entire economy, and constitutional priority of the socialistic pattern of society was laid down in the preamble of the constitution, and this feature had made the economy give a increasingly important role to the public sector, although it must be admitted at certain times that this whole policy was questioned by many people, because it was believed that the public sector was not efficient. However, on the other hand, there was a constitutional obligation on the central government to follow the socialistic pattern of society, and therefore many areas in industry were to some extent justifiably reserved for the public sector. A large number of restrictions were placed on the private sector firms. A licensing policy was adopted, which was mandatory for establishing new units or for a substantial expansion in the existing undertakings. Large-sized firms had to obtain a clearance under the Monopolies and Restrictive Trade Practices Act, that is the MRTPA, which existed at that time. And in addition, an industrial license had to be set up for a new undertaking or for expanding an existing one. There were lots of restrictions also on the use of those industries which were using imported technology and foreign capital. So we can see that in contrast to the present day industrial policy, there were many restrictions. There was a thrust towards the socialistic pattern of society. The private sector was curtailed in many ways, and the dominant industry in the form of heavy industry, capital goods industries and basic industries were all actually assigned in a sense to the public sector industry. Having encountered problems in the previous policies, in the previous policy regime, the new industrial policy was framed and in 1991, and as you would be aware, 1991 being a threshold year, it was the year in which economic liberalization was set out, and India actually set out onto a new path of liberalization, privatization, and further to that to globalization. With the name of the continuity in change, the new industrial policy of 1991 was introduced. It aimed to correct and improve the distortions in the industrial structure of the economy as it existed since 1956. This was the need of the hour. It was the need of the hour to improve upon the economic environment and the investment environment of the country. The policies that were being followed earlier was not very conducive to industrial growth and to investment. The policy was, the 1991 policy was a comprehensive document divided into five parts. These are the following parts of the overall industrial policy. First of all, we have the industrial licensing policy, the foreign investment policy, the foreign technology agreements policy, the policy on public sector, and finally we have the Monopoly and Restrictive Trade Practices Act, which is also known in general terms as the antitrust laws. Now let us first consider the industrial licensing policy. The policy had aimed at the abolition of the licensing system, and it was aimed to make the economy more liberal. Only few industries are left where licensing has to be compulsorily, mandatorily obtained when such industries are being started. Some of these industries are actually, you know, still asked to be governed under this licensing system because of security concerns. So therefore, there are security concerns, there are strategic concerns, and sometimes there are also social reasons for such restrictions. A provision was made that the capital goods can be imported with an automatic clearance if the if adequate foreign exchange was available through foreign equity. That is, if a firm is receiving FDI in the form of foreign equity, then it was given some liberal allowance to import capital goods. And then let us talk about the investment climate, the policies governing the investment climate in the economy after 1991. This is also a part of the industrial policy. Foreign direct investment, as we are aware, is a form of investment where foreign interests or foreign businesses are interested in investing in what we call the host country, India being the host country, and the source from which the foreign direct investment comes is known as the home country. Now, the policy in regard to the foreign direct investment was opened up in 1991, and FDI was allowed in a large number of industries. About 34 industries were placed under the automatic approval route. As is the case in India, as is in many other countries. Also, apart from foreigners, the NRIs, non-resident Indians, were allowed to invest 100% equity investment in on a non-repatriable basis in all activities except in the negative list. Then we have the policy about foreign technology agreements. This is a very important and crucial change that was brought about in the 1991 policy, and that was the automatic approval for technology agreements in high priority industries. The investment limit was up to 1 crore rupees. The provisions were made for 5% royalty to domestic sales and 8% for exports. However, these could not exceed the total of 8% of sales over a period of 10 years from the date of the agreement or 7 years from the commencement of production. Now, what were the changes in the policy regarding public sector? As we have already stated, prior to 1991, public sector was the dominant form of industry. The industrial structure was dominated by the public sector. The major attention was laid on the strategic and essential high-tech infrastructure of the public sector. All the SICK public sector units were referred to the Board for Industrial and Financial Reconstruction, the BIFR, and then there was a plan of disinvestment of many public sector companies that had taken place. It was decided that the board of the public sector companies will be given more powers and better conduct so that they can conduct themselves better and so that their working can become more efficient. Now, about monopoly and monopoly power, we had the Monopoly and Restrictive Trade Practices Act. This MRTP Act was also amended to remove the threshold limit of assets in respect of the companies covered under this act. Many changes were incorporated with regard to the requirements of prior approval from the central government for the establishment of new undertakings, for expansion of the existing undertakings, for merger, for amalgamations, for takeover, and there were changes in the rules regarding the appointment of directors also. According to one of the studies by Nambiar, this policy encouraged economic activity and hence raised the production and employment. Although this change was not spontaneous, it took some time. But in fact, if we look at all these stages, then the initial stage was that of trade liberalization. Increasingly, foreign competition was allowed on Indian soil, and which led to the closure of less competitive firms, and therefore, of course, there were social problems like the loss of jobs, loss of incomes, social unrest, and there was a reduction in the general economic welfare in the initial period. But in the long run, the impact in terms of increased productivity, more competitiveness, greater competitiveness, accelerated growth, and some of the positive features of the new industrial policy after 1991 could be felt. In fact, the growth in the 90s was more robust than the growth that took place in the 80s, although the 80s themselves were not bad as far as the Indian economy is concerned. And although at that time also there was some initiation towards the end of the 80s for some kind of economic liberalization. Nevertheless, 90s was a completely different picture that arose in the context of the growth and the liberalization process. Many authors were of the view that in spite of declining productivity of the industrial sector, but the industrial sector had benefited from the reforms by expanding the capacity. So the liberal environment led to growth in terms of capacity of production. The one area in which the trade policy reforms were most successful is the sector of information technology related services. In the long run, benefits, the benefit was in terms of competitiveness, but the less dynamic enterprises may also tend to disappear, and they did disappear under the increased context of competition that we had imported by virtue of liberalization. Athrey and Kapoor concluded that after liberalization, the concentration declined, and in some industries, the increase, and while it increased in certain other industries. The trade liberalization had a spontaneous effect of increasing imports of products that competed with nationally made products. These imports were either cheaper or at similar quality, of similar quality, or similarly priced with other superior quality attributes. In either case, the domestic producers had faced increased competitive pressure, to which they responded in various ways, mainly by reducing their own price and profit margins. Now, the adjustment in the new market environment usually takes the form of various things that happen, such as cost cutting, product and quality improvement, product design, new products, organizational change, and so on. And all of this happened in the Indian domestic market, and this was because of the removal of protection and increased competition. Many of the weak enterprises, the loss-making enterprises, and the enterprises which were not really dynamic and were not catching up with the world economy in terms of better quality, better competitiveness, new products, variety and so on, were forced to merge with the stronger enterprises, the more active and the dynamic enterprises. To some extent, this did hamper the growth of indigenous industry. It meant that some of these industries were taken over by the FDI, which was allowed to enter into the Indian economy. Every change that is undertaken in the policy sphere can be analyzed with respect to the pros and cons before adoption. But any change is in its essence something which has to occur, and it is a historic necessity. But the change sometimes proves to be beneficial, and sometimes, of course, it is hazardous. Unless the hazards are extreme, it is necessary that an economy adopts and adapts itself to the changing conditions in the global economic environment. And this global economic environment will always have some impact for each of the economies in the world. India was no such exception. India also had to undergo all this policy change. Thus, the policy change has led to some advantages. Now, let us see what these advantages are. Assimilation of the Indian economy with the rest of the world economy. This is one of the biggest advantages. In order to assimilate the Indian economy with the world economy as a whole, the Indian government opened up the doors of Indian industries to other world economies. This was done with the major policy change. Okay. With this, what happened is that the policy of foreign investment was allowed in many sectors. The policy of foreign investment allowed FDI in many sectors of Indian industry. It helped India to get technical know-how, to get capital, and to learn about better processes and practices in management for the production of goods and services, which were earlier not available to the Indian industry and the Indian markets. This opened up a number of opportunities for foreign companies, which created an environment of fierce competition and survival of the fittest in amongst Indian companies. Financial stability is another dimension which needs to be looked into. The Indian economy, which was very weak at the advent of the 90s, was not able to pay even for just 2 weeks of imports before the policy of financial liberalization was introduced. There were lots of, the Indian economy was at the brink of disaster because debts were piling up and the foreign exchange reserves had depleted very fast. And most of the industries did not have funds for investing, and therefore growth was bound to suffer. At this juncture, there was a deregulation of the domestic markets and domestic industry. The domestic markets, which was going through a slowdown at the beginning of the 90s, faced a situation where the government tried to ease the restrictions by allowing foreign companies to make direct investment through Indian companies. There was a check, of course, on the monopoly, which had to go along with these liberalized policies. Otherwise, it might have led to heavy concentration of economic power. With the amendment of the MRTP Act, the government was able to control to some extent the prevailing unfair business practices as well. the emphasis was on checking the monopoly as well as the restrictive trade practices, which actually speaks of the unfair trade practices as well. The merits of the 1991 policy, let us just see. The industrial policy of 1991 is a truly historic policy, although very often it is said that this was as a result of the pressure of the IMF and the World Bank, but it is also to a great extent because of our own realization that the time had come for opening up the economy. The change was overdue and it was welcome by most people. The captains of Indian industry, they were gearing up to compete both internally and internationally and to free themselves from the controls on the industry. The licensing of the of a host of industries and the removal of licensing of a host of industries and the abolition of the registration scheme will free India, and in fact has freed India and its entrepreneurs, and they need not, you know, make so many trips to different government offices to get all kinds of permissions and grants and approvals. They could now concentrate on their own business and grab such business opportunities for growth. Later, the MRTPA was scrapped and companies could go ahead with investment programs without such restrictions and delays. The permission of 51% equity in a wide range of industries has facilitated foreign technology agreements. It will go a long way and will attract and has attracted the foreign investment and technology in many areas. Reforms in the public sector have also taken place, and privatization of the public sector has also improved government undertakings. Finally, in the new policy statement, which is most welcome, it has come as a package. There's a greater reliance on the market. There is a bold attempt at deregulation and a desire to integrate with the world economy. The new industrial policy has many more policies which came with some advantages and disadvantages. However, in view of the position of the Indian economy during this time and this period, basically we could view this entire package more as a boon. This policy aimed at the reduced role of the government, but it cannot be completely ignored. The government cannot be completely ignored. The government is an important part, an integral part of the economy, and always it will remain as a requirement, as a necessary evil, if we would like to call it, to play a regulatory role in the area of infrastructure and utilities, manufacturing industry, and it relies very strongly on the availability of at low cost of energy, transportation, communication. So it is one of the government's important tasks to generate an enabling environment in which these goods and services are available at competitive costs. Although the policy came and was made in the form of a mixed economy, but the industries and the government would always be required to work together. This is an imperative of any growing economy.